Joe, welcome.
Thank you, Ginger.
Thank you so much. And Steve,
thank you.
I really appreciate you guys coming in. We've talked for many, many months about having you come in, and so I'm really grateful that it finally happened.
Well, thanks for having us.
And you brought in your drummer friend.
Yeah, well, he's a lot more interesting than me.
It's Friday the 13th, and I could have been at my dentist, but when I heard about this, I said, you know what, I'll do that another time.
This is actually true.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it is.
He actually rescheduled an appointment to be here.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I've seen you both in concert a lot, you know, because I'm a big, you know, music fan, live music fan, and I go out and about in the city, and I follow the Fab Four, and they talked about Pete Best and My Bonnie, and he was coming in soon at the Cutting Room, the former Cutting Room, and you were there opening up the show.
Yeah, that was quite a while ago. That was around 2010, I think. It was one of Pete's last concert tours here.
And Sid Bernstein was there.
Oh, yeah.
I remember seeing him and Dennis Ferrante.
Oh, yeah. Miss Dennis.
Yeah, and I understand both of you were friends with him, and we all miss him.
Indeed. Yeah. One of the good guys.
For sure.
So how long have you all known each other?
I met Steve a while back. He probably doesn't remember in passing at one of the shows. But our other meeting came about because our drummer, Roger Wolford, unexpectedly passed away at the beginning of 2014. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't really find anybody to replace him.
Yeah.
No one seemed to fit, and it was really difficult to do. So. I said to my partner, Belle, she runs the school, the Monmouth Academy with me, that Steve was in town. He was playing the Cutting Room with some friends of ours.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, you know what, I'm just going to go ask Steve.
Oh, that's great.
Crazy, I just thought. He'll probably say no. I didn't even know who I am, but I said, I'm just going to go ask Steve.
I did say no, but he kept badgering. that's not really true.
It took him all of 2 seconds to say.
Oh, that's great.
Oh, yeah, he knew about me, knew about the drummer.
Good.
And, he expressed his condolences. I said, of course.
Yeah.
And then right after that, we did a festival together.
Yeah, the Abbey Road on the River, which we're still doing.
Really?
It's fun. And, you know, I was happy to help out. And I said, well, you know, I can't promise I'm going to be there for everything, but I'll do as much as I can.
Because you go on tour a lot, more down south.
Right.
And I remember seeing a video of you there.
Whenever Steve's available, he comes in.
I missed a few, but it's inevitable, really.
Yeah.
It's like a collision. But we have some good fun.
You know, you've been a serious drummer for, like, you know, the biggest names in the music industry. Paul McCartney, you know, Ian Hunt.
Lucky, yeah. Ian Hunt.
Who's this Paul guy?
I don't know. But some people
he played with Kanye West.
That's who it is.
I did hear that. Somebody actually said that. Who's that guy with Kanye?
Or that he'll be more popular now that he's been with Kanye.
Yes,
that's something.
Yeah, that was a fun time when I was quite young and didn't expect, but it came about with Denny Lane, who's a mutual friend of ours, and we'd still work with him once in a while when we can.
Yes.
And he happened to move into my hometown, and which is a little village in England, not too far from London, but it's still quite small and rural. And some friends told me that he'd bought a house there, and we ended up running into each other, and he invited me to his housewarming party, which I went to quite early, and walked in to discover a music room with a piano, and McCartney was sitting at the piano.
Wow.
Paul was playing bass, Danny was playing guitar, and there's a drum set with nobody behind it, and I went,
wonderful
story.
I didn't know
that they were looking for a drummer, and I'd just been working with Elton John, and Denny didn't even know, you know, if I was good, bad, or indifferent. Just I was just somebody from the neighborhood that, you know, but we had fun. It was
good
great
for
fun.
You.
Paul had a love of reggae, and so did I. I was actually in one of the very early reggae groups in London called the G.T. Moore and the Reggae Guitars. It was probably the first group I did major touring with, you know.
Good for you.
So we had some fun. And then I got a formal audition, was asked to join the band. So,
wow.
And I was quite young.
How exciting!
It's exciting.
Yeah, it was fun.
That's great.
You know, and I didn't know then, of course, that even though the time was brief, it opens a lot of doors
and
for the future. And And but of course, people think, well, you play with Paul McCartney, you know how all the songs go. No,
no.
Not true.
They're very difficult. I'm learning to play the guitar better than what I've done, and I have a Beatles book, and you know, some of the chords are a little bit more advanced.
It's incredible writing, and
it's
far more complex than you imagine at first, and it's simple at the same time, depending on how you look at it. But the thing that always fascinates me is, no matter how many times I hear the song, I hear something that I didn't notice before.
Oh, interesting.
And it's amazing. Amazing.
Well, I follow the Fab Four, and for about 15 years, and whenever, you know, just didn't think that they could get any better, they do.
Yeah, it's extraordinary. You
know, wonderful what they've done of recreating that music and the sound and the memories. I have some Fab Four fans that are coming on the show in a couple of weeks, and one in particular travels to all their shows, no matter where it is. Isn't that amazing?
That's a great fan.
Yeah, is that
That's
something?
A great fan, yeah.
I joined them on stage a couple of times at Queen's College, and and then once in Liverpool, and they're just fantastic.
Good for you.
I watched them play in Liverpool. They played the White Album in its entirety, including. You know, I thought, how can anybody do it? And it's just amazing.
Yeah, they are amazing. I saw them at the Count Basie Theater a few years ago.
That's coming
and
up.
And they
soon
did.
Yeah.
I think they did Pepper.
Okay.
It's Sergeant Pepper, and it's just amazing with the horns and the strings and
it's
all that.
It's incredible what they've done. So you guys are going to be performing today on the show.
Let's get to a couple songs, sure.
That's wonderful. Now, you're a regular drummer for your band, but you tour a lot as well.
There's a couple of guys that play with you, I think, other than me, but you know, I'm there when I can be.
Quite frequently,
We were
at the Cutting Room last year with Denny Lane, and I remember being there. And
Steve was there.
Mm-hmm. Very good, very good.
We bring in a guy from California, who's a mutual friend, and he fits the bill quite well when Steve's not around.
Okay.
So
wonderful. Yeah. The people travel. That's great. Well, you're a great band to follow. I've been following you
for
a long time.
Thank you.
Yeah, so let's take a break and hear some music, and then when you're done, come on back, right?
Sure. All right.
Great.
All right.
Very
Sounds good.
Head over. All right. Isn't that exciting, everyone? We have Joel Orlando from the Criers, along with Steve Holley.
On this huge drum kit.
What kind of drum is that?
This is called a cajon.
Cajon.
Yeah, C-A-J-O-N. Uh-huh. And arguments about where it came from. Mostly South America, but I've seen pictures of guys in Portugal sitting on fishing crates with wires around them. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not here to say that or judge. I can't really play this thing, but it's great fun.
It sounds good when you do it, though.
That's great. Fake it to make it here in New York.
See, guys that really know how to play this, it's stunning.
Okay, yeah. Joe Orlando.
We're going to do a couple of songs written by myself and my partner, Mick Walsh, who's a great writer and a great friend. Thanks, Mick. This one's called I Think She Knows. She checks her smile before she leaves to take the train. It's a thin disguise she employs to hide her pain. Love has its seasons, sometimes sun and sometimes snow. The winter's here, and inside, I think she knows. Thank you.
outside, I think she knows the summer's here. And inside, I think she knows. I think she knows. I think she knows. I think she knows.
Thank you, thank you.
That was the first song I ever played with Joe and the guys as well. But that was three years ago.
I think it was
the very first song.
Right, yeah. All right, this next one is it's a brand new song. So I've got the lyrics here, because I don't remember. So anyway, this one's called Into the Wind.
Back over. How exciting. That's so fun. Everybody in the studio is watching. We're tweeting about you right now, too.
Yeah.
So,
well, those are fun things to sit on and play and rattle along, you know.
Uh-huh.
In fact, Lawrence and I played the orchestra theme together.
On that acoustic guitar, which is pretty strange. It sounded great, though.
Yeah, well, anybody that knows that tune, it was quite an undertaking.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
Well, tell us about the guitar that you're using.
Oh, that's a Martin... it's actually a John Mayer model,
mm-hmm.
and I bought it last year, I think, at the in Louisville, Kentucky, at mm-hmm. the Iberia on the River Festival. We always try to find that music, find music stores where they're mm-hmm. where we can, and it was an unexpected expense. I sat there, played it, I said to my wife, "Honey, I've got to take this home," and that's a really nice guitar. Martin's a really nice guitar.
Uh-huh, very good.
Yeah, it's really, really love it. It's a really nice guitar, nice instrument.
How many guitars do you have?
I probably have, I'm primarily a bass player.
Okay.
So mm-hmm. I have about four basses,
mm-hmm.
and I have about four acoustic guitars, one 12 string,
mm-hmm.
and then I've got I just got a nice Fender Telecaster that I bought at a gig last year, a nice elite model, really American-made Tele, and I got and I probably had about 11 electric guitars. Yeah.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, I need a house just for those.
Yeah, right. And how many drum kits do you have?
Very little now. Oh. I used to have a lot.
Uh-huh.
But I can tell you that I remember seeing somebody who's quite a famous drummer. He had so many drum sets still in plastic bags. And when I was very young, and I thought, no matter how well I do in this business, I'm never going to have more than I need.
Oh.
And I've kind of stayed that way. At one point, I have a large collection of snare drums, however.
Mm-hmm.
That's a different animal.
They can be very expensive.
But nothing quite like fine guitars. There's nothing quite like that in the drum world. But I like a lot of different percussion, so I have quite an extensive collection of
hand percussion. Well, I love percussion, and it's really, we had somebody who is a professor who teaches like the PhD program at SUNY schools, and I got to go to his percussion lab. It was exciting for me. All these different things that he has.
Well, second to the human voice, it's the oldest instrument in the world.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Well, sure.
What else would it be? Slapping, clapping, you know.
I actually bought that cajon last night.
Did you?
Did you really? Because what's happening, I'm doing a solo album as well, and I wanted it to be more organic, more less produced. Uh-huh. So I'm just going to play acoustic guitar, stand up bass.
Good for
and
you.
So that was its debut performance?
That was its debut performance. Yeah, you're warming it up for me.
It was a surprise for us.
So I was at the store last night purchasing this thing, and I was looking around. I never spent too much time in the percussion departments of those stores. And I'm looking around and all this stuff, and I'm thinking, that's fascinating. And I thought, okay, I'm going to use that.
Because you have a music school, too.
Yeah, exactly.
Boy, I can't imagine how exciting that is. I mean, it's a lot of work, you know? It's a lot of work, but you have to fund, you know, the school with all these different instruments, right?
Yeah.
Is it just a guitar school?
No. We teach all the instruments. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. We teach... As a matter of fact, we have the bulk of our students are not guitar or drum students.
Oh,
they're
really?
Actually classical piano students, violin, cello, and we have a lot of students that take abandoned school, that are in abandoned school.
So we
teach a lot of wind instruments. We teach saxophone, all the saxophones, and the clarinet, flute.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, one of our teachers who's at our school. Rick Brennemer, I think he's played with the Fab Four and all that.
Ron Priya, he's a sax guy, and he played at the Bangladesh concert.
Yeah, he was also just recently at the Festival for Beatles Fans. I had to.
He's been here on the show.
He was scheduled there and couldn't make it in the end. That's right. He was scheduled there.
Okay. I know he was at one of them, but I haven't been there. Tell us about Criers. Now, this is your band.
That's my band, yeah.
And how long have you been together with that?
I started the band in 1991.
Okay.
Yeah. Uh-huh. I started late. I mean, music has always been my love, but mm-hmm. I had, regular corporate job, had a real job
at
one point.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then the one day I came home and said to my wife, who's sitting over there, I said, honey, I just quit my job.
Oh.
And her response was, okay. And
then I
went back to my first love, which was playing music.
Uh-huh.
And then we started, my partner Bell joined in 93. We were an acoustic kind of four-piece original band in Brooklyn. We started out in Brooklyn.
Uh-huh.
And just one thing led to another. We kind of came to Jersey to open up our music school, and that's where I met the other members of the band.
Good for you. The past members
of the band.
And, uh-huh.
And then one day I got to meet Billy J. Kramer.
Mm-hmm.
Through a friend.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, oh, wow, this is interesting. Maybe we could play with them. Maybe we could play with him and back him up.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked. And that's what happened.
Well, there you go. Yeah. You never know who's going to say yes.
Yes,
right?
Exactly.
That's
exactly.
good. Now, is the Criers all original music, or do you do some covers as well?
We do mostly original music. Mm-hmm. The covers we do, we tend to... do for the festival that Gabby wrote on the river,
okay.
where we play some Beatles and some 60s stuff. And,
mm-hmm.
But it's mostly original music.
Well, good for you. Good for you. So, do you have some upcoming tours?
Yes, actually, we'll be at Abbey Road on the River again. We've mm-hmm. been doing it since 2007. It's a really great festival for mm-hmm. all the Beatle freaks out there.
Mm-hmm.
And, it's going to be from May 26th through May 30th in Louisville, Kentucky. And we're going to be playing with Steve. We're going to be playing Sgt. Pepper, Rubber Soul, Revolver. And then we're going to do like a couple of mixed bag sets with some originals and some of the 60s and some solo Beatles stuff.
Okay, good.
Yes. That's up and coming.
Okay, good. And how about you, Steve, in addition to
I'll be playing
Joe's
with
band?
Junior Brown, if you've ever heard of him, for mm-hmm. five shows starting next Thursday mm-hmm. in and around the area at Darryl's house in Pauling on Thursday.
Okay. Uh-huh.
And then joining these guys in Kentucky for the the Abbey Road on the River Fest, and then later on in the year be a fairly extensive tour with Ian Hunter.
Right. Yeah, I understand, but we were talking before the show that you've been playing with him for 30 years.
It's coming on for 30 years, 29 years so far this year. I think it's 30 years in September.
Good for you.
Yeah, it's a long time.
Good for you.
He's great, you know, so.
Would it be okay if I mentioned that Lawrence Juber, who was a bandmate of Steve, is coming to the Monmouth Academy on June 10th.
Uh-huh.
So if anybody wants to come to that show, it's at the Monmouth Academy Musical Arts, June 10th,
so we'll,
with Lawrence Juber.
Okay, and how do and what's the website where we can get more information on that?
Oh, it's just www.monmouthacademy.com.
Monmouthacademy.com.
Right.
Okay, and it's the Monmouth Academy of Musical Arts.
Right.
And I'll be there too if he lets me.
What?
Oh, yeah.
Unless they've replaced me by then.
No.
That's great. Now, have you ever regretted leaving the corporate world for music?
Not in the slightest. No, mm-hmm. I've always wanted to do. This is what I've loved to do my whole life. You mm-hmm. know, I'm doing it, so
it's great.
I'm happy beyond
imagination. Well, it's really a lot of fun for me because I grew up in a small town in the Midwest, and I watched everybody on television or radio, and it's been really fun for me to come here mm-hmm. 30 years later mm-hmm. and be able to be part of the music scene and have a show and have. You know,
you've got a great show. This you have a huge audience. That's
over,
amazing.
Yeah, close to a million.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
That's pretty, and we're all in HD too. Yeah. So you're one of the early guests on our new HD channel. So that's really exciting.
That's great.
Do you have any advice for new students?
Stay with it. Just stay there. Keep your ears open, your eyes open, and never stop learning.
For sure.
That's a great.
That's the main thing. A lot of people, I think, get to a point where they go, "Oh, that's enough. I can just do this," and then, you know. There's always something to learn, always.
For sure.
No matter what you do, of course, not just music, mm-hmm. it's everything. But.
You know, I'm learning to play the guitar better, and I have a long way to go, but I really, you know,
you
have to stick with it.
Yeah. Calluses on your fingers and all that, stick with it. Yeah,
yeah. Sure. When I'm ready to go to bed, it's like, no, I have to practice today. You know, I have a few more minutes to, you know, before I go to bed, I have to. And I'm actually rehearsing my first song. I'm performing here with one of my guests
July.
So I have a goal to look forward to.
That's
but I don't know how good it'll be.
That'll be your debut performance.
Yeah,
that's fantastic.
Right.
It's surprising where the inspiration can come from as
uh-huh.
well. And, you know, there's times when I think with no matter what you do, that it can become difficult or, you know, but you just got to stay, just hang in there, I think.
Uh-huh.
That's the only advice I can really give is to keep an open mind and keep trying to move forwards. You know,
yeah.
There's times that can upset you and push you back, but you just have to climb over those obstacles.
Good
carry
for you.
On, you know.
Good for you.
Yeah.
How many students do you have at your music school?
Probably about now, it's summer's coming up, probably about 400 students.
Good for you.
Yeah, and
it's a lot of work. You know, I'm an accountant, so I know all that.
Yeah,
the
I don't mind doing it. I mean, it gives us a chance to do something outside of ourselves.
Uh-huh.
You know, we play music for us, and of course, we're happy that the audience enjoys it and things like that. But it gives us a chance to give something back, and like I said, to do something that's a little bit bigger than ourselves. Some of my students have really gone on to do great things.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I'm so proud of them.
You were telling some stories before the show about some people that you taught when they were like 8 to 18, and now they're professional singers.
That's
and
right,
they're touring.
Yeah.
It's
true.
You know, with
it's
some
true.
Big names,
yeah.
And it has to be very exciting. You know?
Well, yeah, it just makes me proud of them, and
uh-huh.
you just try to point your students in a good direction, and they have to do the work though.
Uh-huh.
And that's really
making me
thing.
Want to go back to school. It's something I never
famous.
Did, by the way.
Hey, listen, you know, once you start playing those drums, you can go all over the world, right? Yeah.
She's done,
do you play any other instrument other than the drums?
Piano.
Oh, do you really?
Yeah, I started with piano. I studied that. Both my parents are musicians.
Jazz.
So I grew up with big band jazz all around me. And mm-hmm. I spent 4 years studying piano, and really I'm grateful for that because that gives you a lot more insight into music than just, you know, just sitting behind a drum kit and wailing, you know.
Uh-huh.
It's a really good singer as well, Steve.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah,
I like to sing. I attempt to play other instruments, but I'm absolutely. I can just play chords and get around.
What do you think about Prince playing all those instruments?
Oh, it's extraordinary.
What a loss we've had. Yeah.
I played on a stage with him once in Mexico, Marcana Stadium, was working with Joe Cocker, and he came out and watched the show, and then wrote a song for Joe because he enjoyed what he did.
Wow.
And that arrived at in Los Angeles with a purple motorcycle, purple leather clad riding.
Well, we're purple today, you know, in honor of them too.
Yeah, really. So. It's just fantastic inspiration, really. Fantastic. Way too young. Very sorry to see. It's been a desperate year, actually.
Yeah,
in many ways, but, you know.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for joining in on the show.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Thanks for hanging.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming in, making a special appearance. Thanks for being patient with me and on all of our reschedulings and schedulings. And I bothered you so much. Joe, are you available? But thank you so much, because it's really fun for me as a fan to, you know, to know you and see you perform and follow you and then have you as a guest on my show. It's really great for me.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for joining in this afternoon show. Ginger New York, every Friday afternoon at 2 p.m. Check us out every Friday here at MNN TV Studios. We are live here in New York City. Have a safe week. We'll see you next Friday. Thank you, everyone. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having us. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Well done.
Here I stand with head in hand. Turn my face to the wall. If she's gone, I can't go on. Small. Everywhere people stare, each and every day. I can see them laugh at me, and I hear them say, hey, you've got to hide your lover. To hide.